this night on, I use every means in my power to fight you.
Swashbucklers like Robin Hood have been celebrated in story and legend for centuries, for they are a special breed of men, searching for adventure, challenging injustice, laughing at danger. They embody an heroic sense of life, and for decades have lent to the screen rousing escapism and flamboyant excitement. The earliest costume epics were modest presentations and gave little promise of greatness. Performers attired in rented wigs and velvet breeches are crowded onto crude sets, and they enact deeds of villainy and valor with considerable enthusiasm, but questionable skill. Mercifully, audiences do not suffer for long with this kind of folderol. They are saved by the arrival of a remarkable young man. Douglas Fairbanks has very special ideas about how to make adventure films. Already a popular comedy star, Fairbanks is aggressive, charming, and dynamic, an incredible athlete and gymnast. And he injects these qualities into a new kind of screen hero, the Swashbuckler. In The Mark of Zorro, Fairbanks electrifies audiences with unprecedented heroics and dazzling action. Picture after picture, Fairbanks comes to symbolize the very spirit of adventure. Liberated from conventional concerns, he even seems freed from gravity. Douglas Fairbanks, the man, intrigues the public almost as much as Fairbanks, the movie Swashbuckler. For in real life, he rivals the color and romance of his own films. The most popular screen hero of his time, he falls in love, fittingly, with America's sweetheart, Mary Pickford. Mary and Doug marry and reign from their fabled estate called Pickfair. And as one writer comments, Fairbanks and Pickford are living proof of America's chronic belief in happy endings. As a hero to the nation's youth, Fairbanks feels that he can be a crusading influence on his time. He writes 7 books, urging Americans to be ambitious. Banish all thought of losing, he says. And a journalist of the time writes that Fairbanks' popularity is a helpful sign that the blood of America still runs warm and red. Fairbanks becomes a world traveler and sportsman, and wherever he goes, he's regarded as a symbol of American optimism and energy. It's a role that Fairbanks relishes.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great pleasure. Introduce Mr. Johnson, Mr. Bobby Jones, and Sir Harry Lauder.
Yes.
We are all going to Europe to play golf.
Yes.
I'm supposed to be going over to work.
I'm not going to play golf. I'm going to fish.
What? Going to fish?
Yes.
Would you play golf anymore?
No.
You wouldn't play with Bobby Jones?
I lost my ball 2 years ago.
Sono contento d'essere ancora Roma. I'm delighted to be back in Rome again.
Well, I'm delighted to be back in America. I've had a marvelous time in Africa and Spain, shooting pictures, shooting big game. But it's very, very delightful to get back here. I'm on my way to Hollywood to make a picture. I don't know what the title is because we haven't finished writing the picture and we don't know whether it's a boy or a girl, so you can't name it.
With the passing years, Fairbanks loses his zest for motion pictures. Resentful of middle age, he realizes he can't always be a swashbuckler. But he lives to see the swashbuckler enter a new era of pageantry, spectacle, and sound. In Hollywood's version of the Age of Chivalry, no self-respecting monarch would dare make an appearance without full orchestral accompaniment.
Welcome to England, Your Excellency.
Thank you, my lady. May I present my niece, Donna Maria Alvarez de Cordoba.
With sound, audiences can now eavesdrop on the silken and flowery exchanges that determine the fate of empires.
You're very kind, Your Majesty.
May I learn generosity from you, sir?
You are very thoughtful, my lord.
Your Grace.
The royal treasury is empty, sire.
You show great foresight, my lord.
But, Your Grace, there's a mob rising in the city. I had to, Your Grace.
Your Grace. Your Grace. Sire?
No, Your Majesty. Naturally, Your Majesty.
As you wish, Your Majesty.
But of course, Your Majesty.
Don't Your Majesty leave.
Now, this new era of adventure creates not one, but a gallery of colorful swashbucklers. Douglas Fairbanks, Jr. Ronald Coleman. Louis Hayward, John Derrick, Cornell Wilde, Tyrone Power, Paul Henry, and Errol Flynn, the screen's leading swashbuckler.
Up that rigging, you monkeys! Aloft! There's no chains to hold you now!
Whatever survives of the boy in men, this is what responds to the swashbuckler who not only looks and acts, but even speaks like a hero.
Break out those sails and watch them fill with the wind that's carrying us all to freedom! Robin
Franklin! Men, if you're willing to fight for our people, I want you. Are you with me?
What?
Your freedom for my freedom. From now on, I no longer regard myself as a slave.
I'll organize revolt. Exact a death for a death.
Give me the men I need, madam. Put me in command. And if I fail to crush Tyrone, you may take my sword and break it, for I'll never use it again.
Our chance has come. Prove to the world that no man could kill women and children and live to boast of it.
The world of the swashbuckler is conveniently filled with wrongs that must be put to right and with villains whose hearts are as black as their beards.
There's a death sentence for your Robin of Locksley.
I'll have him dangling in a week.
You know this? It is the rosary of pain. It is possible to screw a man's eyes out of his head.
We shall not have the pleasure of taking you and your man back to Spain. Alive.
And perhaps a visit to our dungeons will loosen their tongues.
We shall wait no longer. Take him to the torture chamber. Take these prisoners to the East Tower. Hang the guard a letter through. Take them out and hang them all.
The swashbuckler traditionally moves through this world of danger with a girl on his arm. An incurable romantic, he treats her with a reverence which the modern age might consider naive, but which no heroine could ever resist.
You're the only thing that's real here. All I know is that I'm holding you in my arms. You're so lovely.
If things had been different, you're simply a woman, not a queen.
and I a man with no crown between us, we could have searched heaven and earth for two perfect lovers and ended the search for ourselves. Of all the things on this earth that I'm now to leave, I care about leaving none of them. But you.
In the garden of a convent in Peru, there's a beautiful statue. The nuns call it Nuestra Señora de las Flores. That's how I'll always think of you, as my Lady of the Roses.
Romance thrives best when interrupted by bittersweet farewells, when the hero must sail away on the real business of swashbuckling. Like this from the magnificent Seahawk are rarely the climax of the swashbuckling film. The hero and the audience know that as their victorious galleon sails into the sunset, there is much more to come. The high point of the swashbuckler epic is the traditional sword play, but nothing is as satisfying as a noisy lunging and slashing duel. Sabers are obviously great fun. Even the heroines cannot resist giving it a try. Swashbuckling, however, is best left to men, and none ever surpassed Errol Flynn. His jaw is firmer, his parries and lunges are quicker, his courage is legendary. After watching Errol Flynn on a Saturday afternoon, is there a boy alive who wouldn't have traded his baseball mitt or his bicycle to be a Robin Hood or a Captain Blood?
You've come to Nottingham once too often.
When this is over, my friend, there'll be no need for me to come again.
Your sword, Gisborne.
Errol Flynn emerges as Hollywood's leading swashbuckler, both on and off the screen. I allow myself, he says, to be understood as a colorful fragment in a drab world. And he boasts, if I have any genius, it is a genius for living. A South Sea adventurer in his youth, Flynn cuts a gaudy figure in Hollywood. He is a brawler and a spender, a connoisseur of old whiskey and young women. He revels in his reputation as a lady killer and prides himself on all kinds of athletic prowess. Without half trying, he's one of Hollywood's finest tennis players. Errol Flynn knows, however, that his dashing public image is a facade. Years later, he'll write that he squandered himself on drink and emotional adventures. As a boy, he had imagined himself a real-life hero, a Sir Galahad. And now he realizes he constantly betrays that youthful ideal. Flynn marries three times. His last wife, Patrice Wymore, an actress. I wanted marriage badly, he writes. I was lonely, lost, never far from despondency. And when I asked her what she saw in me, she said, I feel sorry for you. By the early 1950s, as he embarks on a Korean USO tour with Jack Benny, Errol Flynn is a prematurely aging and tired man. His career is fading away. All that's left is his reputation as a playboy of the Western world. He is sensitive enough now to be embarrassed by this garish reputation, but he willingly becomes a parody of himself. He speaks of himself now as being washed up and broke. The $7 million that he earned has somehow slipped through his fingers, along with his health and his hopes. He is 43 years old. He wonders why he, who had so much charm and fame, has come to this. And it never dawns on him that all his life he had drifted from sensation to sensation without goals or values. Now he says, I can't seem to do anything but drift. It could be a sort of moral gangrene. Near the end, he recalls with both embarrassment and a touch of pride his old movies, in which he achieved a heroism that he never brought to his own life.
Our objective is certain! Forward!
This is the image that Errol Flynn left, if not in life, then on the screen. In films like the magnificent Charge of the Light Brigade. This is swashbuckling at its best. The essence of all that figures like Fairbanks and Flynn brought to the screen. Action, spectacle, and heroics on a grand scale.
Right into certain death.